Shall we look to God in prayer? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, we bless, praise, and thank the Holy Name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we all stand and we shall follow the order of service? Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise with songs of praise.
For the Lord is a great God and a great ruler above all gods, in whose hands are the depths of the earth and also the heights of the mountains.
The sea belongs to the God who made it, and the dry land because God formed it.
While we are standing, we shall sing hymn of praise number 62, All Creatures of our God and King. Hymn number 62.
Rising morning, praise rejoice.
believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
For a responsive reading, we shall remain standing and we shall turn to Psalm 145, verses 8 to 21, and Psalm number 857. May I invite Neeraj to please come forward.
Responsive reading taken from Psalm 145, 8 to 21. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
The Lord is good to all, his compassion over all his creation.
All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord,
and your faithful ones shall bless you.
They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom
and tell of your power,
to make known to all people your mighty deeds
and the glorious splendor of your kingdom.
Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom,
and your dominion endures throughout all generations.
The Lord upholds all who are falling
and raises up all who are bowed down.
The eyes of all look to you,
and you give them their food in due season.
You open your hand.
You satisfy the desire of every living being.
All the Lord's ways are just.
All the Lord's doings are right.
The Lord is near to all who call.
To all who call upon the Lord in truth.
The Lord fulfills the desire of all the faithful.
And hears their cry and saves them.
All who love the Lord preserves.
All the wicked the Lord destroys.
My mouth will speak praise of the Lord.
Let all flesh bless God's holy name forever and ever.
Thank you, Lord, above Father God, Heavenly Lord. forgiving our sins, and also, Lord, our Father God, giving us special place in the holy presence and giving us the opportunity, privilege to call you our Father and also utter the holy name from our lips. Gracious Lord, our Lord, thank you so much for every privilege that you've given and added unto our lives. We, the church, call you to bless, praise, and thank the holy name. Father God, our Lord, we once again commit our church, ourselves, thy sons and daughters, thy called and chosen one, into the holy presence. Beautiful church, congregation, and the family that you've given to us. Lord, our Father God, you have united with each other, and you have made us one family. And also, Lord, our Father God, gracious Lord, you have given us privilege, opportunity to edify each other and lift up each other in our prayers. Lord, our Father God, we the church, Centenary Methodist Church, want to bless, praise, and thank thy holy name. Special Lord, our Father God, Heavenly Lord, in a special way, thank you so much for being thus far with each one of us. And Lord, our Father God, blessing thy peoples and protecting thy people. We continue to bring ourselves, your church, thy sons and daughters into the holy presence, seeking thy continuous power, thy blessing, thy protection, thy anointing, and also thy privilege, authority to share thy holy and precious word with other people. Lord, our Father God, Heavenly Lord, bless us in Centenary Methodist Church, bless our ministry, as Lord, our Father God, gracious Lord, not only you have blessed us, but you have made us channel of blessing for many. So we are able to support and bless and become channel of blessing for our ruler pastors, our missionaries, our seminary students, and also towards the orphan and widows. Gracious Lord, our Lord, thus far you have really blessed us, and you have made us channel of blessing for many. And also, Lord, our Father God, you have given us this privilege to invest in the life of many and become salt and light and new hope through Lord Jesus Christ in the life of many people. Father God, our Lord, we call you to seek the privileges into our church, into our lives, and also into the ministry of our church. And gracious Lord, our Lord, Heavenly Lord, we pray, let the leading power and anointing of the Holy Spirit continue to be upon us, as we belong to you and we are the part of the universal body of Lord Jesus Christ. So whatever we do, Heavenly Father, gracious Lord, let your name be glorified. And through our all the activities, gatherings, and also programs and assemblies, Lord, our Father God, gracious Lord, we be edified. And also, Lord, our Father God, we will be edified. Those are weak in their faith and growing in their faith. Father God, our Lord, Heavenly Lord, bless the church and bless the ministry of our church. We want to bring our auxiliaries, our Sunday School, Methodist Youth Fellowship, WSES, and Methodist Men's Fellowship. We bring our four auxiliaries into the Holy Presence. Their leadership, those who have given themselves and have taken the responsibilities to serve these auxiliaries and to strengthen their church and strengthen their congregation. We in a special way want to pray for our Sunday School children, all the little ones as they are growing. Father God, our Lord, we continue to seek the hand of wisdom and also hand of growth upon their physical bodies and also maturity. Lord, our Father God, gracious Lord, you bless our all the little ones in the mighty name of Jesus, and be with them. Be with them, our Father God, in their studies, and also, Lord, our Father God, they would always carry the fear of the Lord in their lives. We want to bring a Methodist Youth Fellowship, all the youngsters, into the Holy Presence, as they have given themselves to you. Father God, our Lord, the hand of protection be upon them, and protect them from all kind of evil, temptation, and wickedness of this world. Lord, our Father God, bless the studies, those who are studying, bless the works of their hands, those who are working, and those who are preparing themselves to appear in a competitive exams. Lord, our Father God, grant them needed wisdom and also thy favor, and favor with thy people. Father God, our Lord, bless the youngsters and be with them. Those who are praying for their life partners, Lord, our Father God, you know our present, our past, and our future, and know, you know what is best for us. Therefore, our Father God, gracious Lord, we bring our youngsters into the Holy Presence. We want to pray for our WSES, our ladies, who come together. meditating upon the holy and precious word, pray for each other. You bless their gatherings, and also, Lord, our Father God, bless all the ladies of our congregation. Make them prayer warriors and also backbone of our church. We want to bring our men's fellowship into the holy presence, our Methodist men's fellowship, as we meet every fourth or third Sunday. Lord, Father God, our Lord, we see the holy presence. And thank you, Lord, our Father God, thus far. You have blessed our Methodist men's fellowship, and you have blessed many lives. Gracious Lord, our Lord, we want to bring all the men of our congregation into the holy presence. Lord, our Father God, as they earn bread for their family, Father God, our Lord, you bless the coming and going, and also, gracious Lord, our Lord, bless the works of their hands, and also bless their income. Lord, our Father God, wherever your thy people, thy sons and daughters are working, gracious Lord, our Lord, you make them faithful to their offices, and also, Lord, our Father God, light and salt among their colleagues. Father God, our Lord, Heavenly Lord, we thank you so much once again for the goodness, the faithfulness upon our auxiliaries and through our auxiliaries upon the congregation. We continue to bring our people, our pastoral committee, pastoral conference, and all other committees, those who have given themselves to serve you as their people, sons and daughters, their voluntary, serve the church. Gracious Lord, our Lord, we continue to seek the anointing power as we come together to discuss various things about our church and related to our church. Gracious Lord, Heavenly Lord, you grant us wisdom and the leading of the Holy Spirit, so thy will be fulfilled in and through our church. Lord, Father God, our Lord, those who are helping our church, organizing online church services, music, and other things. Gracious Lord, our Lord, you be with them and bless them. And in return, Lord, our Father God, the hand of blessing shower, hand of blessing and protection continue to be upon them, and the blessing may shower upon them. Father God, our Lord, you bless our office staff, Jacob, Suresh Manju, and all the coordination workers, those who look after our church and all the administration of the church. Gracious Lord, our Lord, you bless all the workers of our church. Gracious Lord, our Lord, we the church continue to bless, praise, and thank thy holy name. Father God, our Lord, we thank you so much once again for our congregation. We want to bless, praise, and thank thy holy name for all those who are celebrating their birthdays and wedding anniversaries during this week. We want to pray for Mr. Gladwin Lal, Jacob Nainan, Manya Humble, Wing Commander N.J.C. Patrick, Roshan Idikule, Moses Prakasham. Thank you, Lord, our Father God, Heavenly Lord, for the sons and daughters as they celebrate their birthdays during this week. The life which you have given to them, Lord, our Father God, be under thy protection and under thy control, so they would be protected from all kind of harm and from all kind of danger. Gracious Lord, our Lord, you be with them in the years to come and bless them as thus far you have blessed them and you have shown your favor upon each one of them. Lord, Father God, our Lord, we want to bless them, each one of them, in the mighty name of Jesus. Father God, our Lord, thank you so much for the couples, those are celebrating their wedding anniversaries during this week. Thank you, Lord, our Father God, for Dr. Shiny Suman and Neeraj Kosala as they celebrate their wedding anniversary on 24th. Lord, our Father God, gracious Lord, you be with them and bless them. Thank you, Lord, our Father God, for the couple as they are committed to you and towards the church. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, our Father God, we want to bless them. Father God, thank you so much for Evangeline and Elvis as they celebrate their wedding anniversary on 26th of this month. Thank you, Lord, our Father God, also for both of them and their family as they are committed to you and they have given themselves to you. Lord, our Father God, you bless their lives, bless their married life, and bless their families. Their blessings be upon them. Lord, Father God, our Lord, thank you so much for all of us, for the gift of the life, for every blessing that you showered upon us. Heavenly Father, our Lord, in a special way, we want to bring our congregation, thy sons and daughters, those are not feeling well. Father God, our Lord, we want to pray for Kripa and Anisha Russell. Lord, our Father God, we seek the healing upon them. Lord, our Father God, gracious Lord, you are the healer. And our Father God, gracious Lord, you are the creator of our Lord. Therefore, our Father God, we commit thy daughters into the holy presence for the healing. We want to pray Lord, our Father God, you strengthen her and be with her and completely grant the healing. Father God, our Lord, we want to pray for all the sons and daughters, those who are not feeling well, and also Mrs. Nandini Kapoor and others, those who have shared their prayer request, and also Lord, our Father God, gracious Lord, those who have asked us to keep us in prayer. Gracious Lord, our Lord, you know our hearts and minds. You are the Lord who searches our hearts. Therefore, our Father God, gracious Lord, we want to surrender all those who are not feeling well, mentally, physically, or spiritually. Gracious Lord, our Lord, you are the Jehovah Rapha. Grant the healing and the grant the power, healing power to each one of them. Father God, our Lord, we want to pray for the grieved families, those who have lost their dear and near ones. Lord, our Father God, gracious Lord, have the peace and have the comfort upon the families. Gracious Lord, Heavenly Lord, our Lord, thank you so much once again for our church, for our congregation. We want you to seek the power, the presence, and the anointing upon each one of us. Lord, our Father God, we commit Brother Anand into the Holy Presence as he comes and deliver and share the holy and precious word. We want you to seek the anointing power upon him. Thank you, Lord, our Father God, his commitment to you and towards the church and towards the ministry. Thank you, Lord, our Father God, for him and Mrs. Villa, as both of them, they are committed to you and towards the ministry to share the word in North India. Lord, our Father God, use them in a mighty way and also use them to extend the kingdom upon this earth. Father God, our Lord, want you to help us to receive the holy and precious word. We want to pray once again, Lord, our Father God, for the universal body of the Lord Jesus Christ, all the churches, all the denominations, and Lord, our Father God, we are seeking the anointing of the Spirit upon all the churches and upon the leaders of the churches. We want to pray for the Christ Church in India, especially, Lord, our Father God, gracious Lord, upon our Delhi Regional Conference, our pastors, our missionaries, seminary students, our ruler pastors, deaconesses, heads of the institutions, and lay leadership. Lord, our Father God, you bless the ministry of our Delhi Regional Conference. We want to pray, Lord, our Father God, for the persecuted church, that our brothers and sisters who are passing through the time of persecution. Lord, our Father God, have the protection and have the mercy upon them. Father God, our Lord, thank you so much for the beautiful country that you've given to us. We want to pray for our Prime Minister, President, Chief Minister, and Chief Ministers of other states. We want to pray for the government, central government, and the state governments. And Lord, our Father God, all the people, those that are into administration. Bless our country, bless our people, and bless their sons and daughters, and bless our government, and bless the leadership of our country. Bless, Lord, our Father God, our judiciary system, and also seeking thy wisdom, thy guidance with all of them. Lord, our Father God, we see thy blessing upon all the people, those are into administration, especially with the police, army, air force, and navy, as they have given themselves to serve our country, protect our country, and protect the borders of our country. Lord, our Father God, we bless our soldiers and their families. Thank you, Lord, our Father God, Heavenly Lord, giving us this wonderful country so we in freedom could worship and adore thy holy name. Father God, our Lord, you bless our people and bless all the citizens of our country. We want to pray especially for all the orphans and widows and downtrodden who are rejected by the society. Lord, our Father God, have their provisions in their lives and have their blessings upon them. Father God, raise your church, raise your people to serve them and to be with them. Lord, Heavenly Father, gracious Lord, we want you to bless you, praise you, and thank you. And once again, we want to glorify the holy name, bringing us together to come into the holy sanctuary as well as worship the holy name online. Father God, want you to make us one in the Holy Spirit and unite us. We bless you, Lord, we praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, who brought us to pray in this manner. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive our trespasses, as you forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May I request our singing team to please come forward and lead us into the time of singing.
Good morning, church. Hebrews 13 verse 15 says, through Jesus therefore let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly professes his name. Our first two songs are Praises Rising and Here Now.
Comprehend, but no mind on that could understand. came like madness, poured out in blood, washed from men. It makes no sense, but this is grace. And know you're with me in this place. See now, all I know is I know that you are here now. Still my heart, let your voice be all I hear now. Spirit, breathe like the wind, come have your way. Cause I know you're in this place. It makes a fool of what makes sense. Grace found my heart where logic. Justice call for all my debt. The friend of sinners came instead. Your ways are higher, your thoughts are wilder. Love came like madness, poured out in blood, washed from men. It makes no sense, but this is.
And all you're in. to the Lord. Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah to the Lord.
2 Corinthians verse 4, 6 to 12 says, "For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made his light shine our hearts to give us the light of knowledge of God's glory, displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay, to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. We always carry around our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may be revealed in our mortal body. So then death is at work in us, but life is at work in you." Our next two songs are "My Dear to Save" and "By Rest the Sun." I request the congregation to please stand up.
Of the risen King, Jesus, shine a light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King.
Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Shine a light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King.
Jesus,
shine a light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine a light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen
Scripture reading is taken from Acts chapter 4, verses 8 to 14. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved." When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. But since they could see the man who had been healed standing there with them, there was nothing they could say. May the Lord add blessings to the reading and hearing of his word. Amen.
Thank you, sister, for the word. When you look at what we read in the book of Acts, some of us who are following the series on the transformation of the life of Peter, you'll be wondering if it is the same Peter that was the person who wanted to chop off the ear of the soldier, or say even when he was caught red-handed backsliding, that even if others betray, I will not betray you. Or the same person who was so foolish as to even counsel the Lord that he should not suffer and die, which evoked the sharp response from our Lord Jesus, where he actually called Peter, "Satan, get thee behind me, Satan." Well, the transformation of Peter is a little bit of a baffle for many people. How can one person change his entire personality in a short period of time? Well, there are turning points in Peter's life. Let us look at the turning points in Peter's life. What is it that led to his transformation? So if you, just for a quick recall, let us look at the old Peter and the new Peter. The old Peter was very undiscerning. He did not know what to say when the Lord Jesus appeared along with Moses and Elijah. That same Peter has become a very insightful preacher, where he is preaching in the book of Acts and 3,000 converts coming. That old Peter was very childish. He wanted to walk on water because Jesus was walking on water. But that same Peter in 1 Peter and in 2 Peter, he's very balanced. He says, "Listen, I myself was a witness, but even though I'm a witness, you have the word of God made more certain." The old Peter was very worldly. When the Lord Jesus told, "Wherever two or three of you are gathered in my name, I am with them, and whatever you forgive here will be forgiven in heaven," he asked, "How many times should I forgive my brother? Is it 7 times or 70 times 7? That same immature person is very balanced, and he is, if you look at 1 Peter chapter 3, how he talks about the inner beauty. External adornment cannot bring in. That immature Peter is very balanced. That unreliable Peter, if you remember in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Peter and his disciples were asked by the Lord Jesus, "Watch and pray with me," he was not reliable. He was found sleeping. But this same Peter, history says, that he was faithful to the end, and when the Romans wanted to crucify him, he said, "Listen, crucifying is your call, but I don't want to be crucified like the Lord Jesus, like my Lord. So if you have to crucify me, crucify me upside down. History tells that Peter was crucified upside down because he said, I am not worthy to die the death of my own Lord. That Peter who was so unreliable in the Garden of Gethsemane, so impulsive in the same Garden of Gethsemane where he chopped off the ear, this Peter is saying, I am willing to die even to the end. That Peter who was impulsive is very restrained, and we will see that in this conflict with Paul. How in Galatians chapter 2, when Paul called Peter a hypocrite, he is completely restrained. And that is where the big turning point is, that old Peter who was self-confident, very proud, very boastful, he is humble in 1 Peter chapter 5, if you see in the way he addresses his disciples. So let us look at what are the five turning points of the life of Peter. Yes, the five turning points in the life of Peter is, the first one is the promise of the Lord Jesus. The second one is the prayer of the Lord Jesus. The third one is the presence and coaching of the Lord, the power, and the fourth one would be the power of the Holy Spirit at work in his life, and the fifth one is the perfection through believers. And while we'll quickly go through the four, we'll just spend a few moments in reflection on the fifth one, the perfection through the life of other believers. Let us look at the first one, turning point of the Lord Jesus. Can I request you to keep the laptop here on the line of sight here? Thank you. So if you look at the prayer of the Lord Jesus, the big and the first turning point that came about in the transformation of the life of Peter is the actual prayer that the Lord Jesus prayed. Next time when I come, possibly the next Sunday of next month, I will be speaking on the similar resources that will be available for us. The Lord Jesus prayed for Peter. Well, we'll see that the Lord Jesus also prays for us. This was the first and the biggest turning point of Peter's life, where the Lord Jesus prays for him and says, Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. And if you actually see in the prayer of the Lord Jesus in John chapter 17, which is actually the Lord's prayer. You know, even in the Methodist tradition, after the pastoral prayer, we pray, Our Father who art in heaven. That is not the Lord's prayer. That is the disciples' prayer. That is the prayer for the disciples. John chapter 17 is the prayer that the Lord Jesus prayed. And in John chapter 17, verse 15, the Lord Jesus prays not only for Peter, but for all others, where he says, My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. The Lord Jesus prayed for Peter, which was a big turning point in the life of Peter. The second one, turning point, is the presence of the Lord Jesus himself. We saw the passage that was read. What was the big transformation point that even other people observed when they saw these people change, transformed? Acts chapter 4 verse 13 presents it beautifully. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and took note of the fact that these men had been with Jesus. Now, if you go back to the Greek, which is what the large portion of, or the entire portion of New Testament is written, and if you look at that word for unschooled in the Greek, you will find that the word unschooled is in the Greek idiotis, from which we get the English word idiot. So basically, when the people saw the disciples, they saw them as a bunch of idiots. But those bunch of idiots had courage and boldness. Why? because the Lord Jesus was with them. And if you actually see Mark chapter 2 verse 15, he appointed them specifically to be with them. Even when the Lord Jesus asked all the disciples, John, in John chapter 6 verse 67 and 68, Peter says, when the Lord Jesus says, you all want to leave me? They said, no. There is a transformational presence that is there in being with you. And Peter says, Lord, to whom shall we go? So that is the second turning point in the life of Peter. Now, if you look at the third turning point in the life of Peter, you'll find that the third point, turning point, is something that will be available for us also, and that is the power of the Holy Spirit. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Again, in this book, Acts chapter 1 verse 8, that word power in the original Greek is the word dunamis, from which we get our English word dynamite. So the power that we receive when we receive the Holy Spirit is such a big power, such a transformational power, that you can even blast mountains. Dunamis, dynamite. Some of us who have received the power, we are walking around as if we are kind of half-broken chicken or something like that. You know, I mean, in our world, we need to recognize that the person who is received the Holy Spirit has got tremendous power, no weak power. Whether it is in the corporate world or in an institution or in a neighborhood, wherever you are working, the child of God who has got the Holy Spirit has got the dynamic power, the dunamite power that is there within us. Another time I had spoken in another place, why do we have Christians who are living powerless life? That is because they are not living according to the power of the Holy Spirit. Peter was transformed. In fact, Paul, writing to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7, he says, the spirit that you have received is not a spirit of timidity, but of love, of power, and of self-control. Now let us look at the turning point, the biggest turning point that happened. What is the turning point that we need to look at? The turning point is the conflict. For this, I will go one step later on. And if you see in Galatians chapter 2, Paul calls Peter a hypocrite. The background is very, very difficult for us to understand. So let me take you to the background. Somehow our new remote is giving us his own challenge. Okay, let's not break with technology. Let me go back to this. Yes, let us look at this. I want you to, when you go home, read Galatians chapter 2. The background is, Paul is upset with the fact that Peter is mixing with the Gentiles. Paul is upset with the fact that Peter has gone to the house of a Gentile. In reality, actually, if you look at the background, you find that Paul is an apostle for the Gentiles, whereas Peter is the apostle for the Jews. Sometimes God will use another person in your place to do what you could have done. Technically speaking, the entire ministry of the Gentiles was belonging to the territory of Paul. I want you all to reflect. How do you respond when God uses somebody else to be as successful as you would have been, but in your territory? How will it be if God uses somebody in your domain to be as successful as you are? God brings people into our lives just to transform us. Now, in that entire passage, as we can see later on in Galatians chapter 2, we see Paul very eye-centric. He is bothered about himself.
He is upset over the fact that somebody has come and converted a Gentile family. And he has become successful and he's been accepted. Worse, that conversion, they even receive the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 10, if you see, when Cornelius was praying, his prayers were heard even though he was a heathen. And Peter, when he was up there in the roof, God had to speak to him in a very special way. He brought a carpet of animals, both clean and unclean, and said, get up, kill and eat. Peter, being a true blue Jew, said, no, never, no Lord, I cannot do it. I've never eaten anything unclean. So it is not that Peter went willingly to a Gentile's home. Peter had his own resistance. 2 Sundays later, we will see how the Lord works through the life of Peter to change him. So Peter went with a lot of kicking and screaming, and he went there and God blessed that ministry. As God blessed that ministry, he continued to be with them. The elders were upset about it. They gave him an opportunity to explain, and he explained. Peter was not given that opportunity by Paul. If you look at it in Galatians chapter 2, outrightly he calls him, you hypocrite, in front of them all. Now, when you read the book of Galatians, we see only Paul's actions. We don't see Peter's response. But that is where Peter is getting transformed, and that is the final 5th turning point in Peter's life. When Paul calls him a hypocrite, he just takes it as a ministry. In the school of discipleship, God will use many people. Some of them will be even from the house of God. If you look at in the book of Nehemiah, Nehemiah had opposition from everywhere. But his biggest opposition was not from Sanballat and Tobiah, it was from the Jews. Sometimes we need to praise God for our church, because there will be imperfect people in our church who will bring about perfection in our lives. Of course, one person in his extreme sense, he said, why do I need enemies when I've got friends like these? Yes, there will be imperfect people in the church. There will be imperfect people in our family who will bring about perfection in us. And here I want to mention one thing. Nearly all of us know how to react to situations. Very few of us know how to respond to situations. Paul reacted to that news that he heard, that Peter mingled with the Gentiles. Peter just subdued. So in that conflict later on, if you see that actual conflict, what was that conflict? Paul called Peter a hypocrite in front of them all, Galatians chapter 1, Chapter 2, verse 1 to 14. Peter never retaliated. There were 3 rules that Paul himself had written, which Paul violated. First thing is, when you hear something wrong is being done about an elder, you should not entertain that. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 18. Paul himself gave that rule, where he said, do not entertain an accusation against an elder unless it is brought by 2 or 3 witnesses. Second protocol that Paul violated was what the Lord Jesus laid out. How do you correct a person? Matthew chapter 18, verse 15 to 17. If your brother sins against you, go and show him his fault just between the two of you. Step number one. Step number two, if he does not listen when you go one-on-one, then take one or two other elders and talk to him. Step number two. Step number three, if he refuses to listen to them, then tell to the church. Step number three. The Lord Jesus gave the protocol. Paul violated all these three and went to step number four, went to the public. First, if somebody is doing anything wrong with you, go go to that person one-on-one. If he or she does not listen, then take one or two elders, not one or two ordinary people. If that also doesn't work, then go to the church. We have no liberty to go to the outside world and wash our dirty linen. Paul violated all this and went to step number 4 in the open public, in front of the mall. If you see in Galatians chapter 2, verse 1 to 14, he calls Peter a hypocrite. But Peter subdues it. In fact, Paul did not even give Peter a chance to defend himself, as the elders did. If you go and see Acts chapter 11, verse 3 to 18. The elders also were upset of the fact that Peter had mingled with the Gentiles. But when they had given him an opportunity, he went and explained, yes, I went with resistance and this is what happened to me. So you see the passive side of Peter, and now you go to Peter referring to Paul in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 15 and 16. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 15 and 16. I will read it for you. Bear in mind that our Lord's patience means salvation, just as our dear brother Paul wrote with the wisdom that God gave him. He writes the same way in all these letters, which contain some things that are hard for people to understand, which ignorant and unstable people distort, as they do with other scriptures, to their own destruction. 2 Peter chapter 3, I want you to follow it in your Bible. See, we love technology, and I also love technology. You know why? Sometimes it works. They went into a new remote which has got a range limitation. They have not tested the range. So let's go. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 15 and 16. Let me read it again. Many years later, the person who offended him, Paul, he is writing about him. And what is he writing? He is writing, he says, bear in mind that the Lord's patience means salvation, just as our dear brother Paul wrote to you. Who is this dear brother Paul? The person who offended him, the person who called him a hypocrite, publicly humiliated him. So I want to, as we come to a close, I want you to reflect on a transformation that possibly could and even is happening in your life. And we can do the acid test. 3 acid tests we will have. So if the person there handling the computer can bring it to Galatians, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 15 and 16. So I want you to think of somebody who has hurt you. Somebody who has publicly humiliated you. Yes, thank you, brother. Somebody who has publicly humiliated you. Somebody who has insulted you. Somebody who has degraded you. Now, I want you to go through 3 acid tests. First thing is, write down the name of that person somewhere. Just think about that person. How does it appear for you when you think about that person? Can you call that person dear brother? Or will you speak in special language? Oh, that person, asterisk, exclamation mark, percentage, hash. What comes to your mind when you think of that person who offended you? When Peter thinks about Paul, he calls him dear brother. That matter is resolved, because while Peter may be in his own reconciliation, he has forgiven Paul, who may not have even asked for forgiveness. There is no record in the Bible of Paul ever asking Peter for forgiveness for that public insult. But Peter, from his side, he has forgiven. First one, dear brother Paul. Second one, he writes to in the same way in all these letters, speaking in them of his, of these things, with the wisdom that God gave him. The second acid test is, as you think about that person, can you think of positive things about that person? First one is, can you speak with high emotion, with a lot of affection? Possibly not. We would have failed acid test number one. But go on to the next one. Not only will you have to think about that person with positive emotion, you will have to think about that person with a lot of positive things to say, with the wisdom that God gave him. The third acid test is coming in verse 16. His letters contain some things that are hard to understand, which ignorant and unstable people distort, as they do with other scriptures, to their own destruction. Can you think about something negative in that person and speak defensively? Here is a situation where Peter is talking about something that is negative in Paul's writings. His letters contain some things that are hard to understand. Paul is like that. He is a very philosophical person. His letters contain some things that are hard to understand. But what does Peter do? He defends it. He says, his letters contain some things that are hard to understand, which ignorant and unstable people distort, as they do with other scriptures. Which means what Paul is writing is the scriptures. Are you able to convert a negative thing about that person to a positive thing? That is the acid test number 5. Let us go on. So Paul violated those three rules. Can we really get that into our life? So in closing, I want to ask you some questions. A reality check. First one, have I grown spiritually? Ask yourselves the question. Yes, Peter, we saw his transformation. Have I grown spiritually? If yes, what were the major factors that caused this? Has it affected my circle of influence, my family, my friends? Have they commented on it? If not, why not? Now, sometimes when some people look at you after 10 years or 15 years and they say, oh, you are the same person, we don't know whether it's a compliment or not. I mean, we had a 40-year reunion of our school. Now, in that 40-year reunion of our school, I had met some people only after 40 years. But some people I had kind of stayed in touch, and I possibly had met them 5 years ago or 10 years ago. And some people I had met 1 year ago before that reunion. So as I met all these people, and we were, when you go back, and I don't know how it is with you, when you go back to your old school reunion, you behave exactly the same way as you behaved when you were kids or that age. So we were joking and everything. One person, he said, hey, Anand, you are the same person. Another person, he said, Anand, you have changed a lot. In fact, one person, he said, you have become a big shot. I said, no, I'm not yet a big shot. I will be a big shot one day when I'm short. But now I'm not yet a big shot. So they said, man, you got the same sense of humor. You are the same person. And then another person, he said, hey, Anand, you've lost a lot of weight. Two others, they came and said, hey, but Anand, you put on a lot of weight. Different people who met me at different times. In that conversation, I understood one subject in physics that I never understood when I was in school, and that is the theory of relativity. But having said that, in your family, when they look at you, do they say you have changed positively? Have they noticed any change? Second one, has my walk with God deepened in intimacy and passion? If yes, what are the significant factors and experience that have precipitated this? What are the major challenges or changes that have taken place? Third question, what would I do differently? What would I have done differently if I knew years ago what I know now? You know, the problem with life is lived forward, but history is written backward. So if we knew then what I know now, we would do things differently. So the question that you were to ask is, what would I have done differently if I knew years ago what I know now? What would I have done differently as a teenager? What would I have differently done as a young adult? What would I have done differently as a spouse? What would I have done differently as a parent? These are all questions which will reflect on the turning point in our life. As I asked Pastor to come and pray, let us reflect on, yes, Peter, it was a great transformation, but have we transformed?
Thank you, Brother Anand, for taking out your precious time to be with us and to minister our church with the word of God. May God continue to bless you and your wife, Bella, as you have given yourself in the ministry and to serve the Lord. And we appreciate your efforts, volunteering. You have offered yourself to our church and to many other churches to minister the word of God. Thank you so much. We shall all stand and we shall sing hymn number 395, Take Time to Be Holy, Hymn of Commitment. We shall offer offerings and thanksgiving for the glory of the Lord during the singing of this hymn.
Love. Morning, church. We welcome you all. Please join us at the parsonage for the time of fellowship. On behalf of the church, I thank Brother Anand Pillai for bringing us the message today morning. Those of you who are worshiping with us for the first time, you may kindly rise and introduce yourself. Yes, please. If anybody's got a mic. Yeah, please. Thank you. Please join us at the parsonage for the fellowship. Brother Manjeet, if you can please guide them. Yeah. Thank you. Welcome. The finance committee will meet today after the church service in the parsonage. The Methodist men will also meet today in the parsonage after the church service. The chairpersons of various committees, auxiliaries, may kindly submit their schedule for this year, as the church is preparing a calendar for the activities for this year 23-24. Please submit your schedules to the pastor so that as we are preparing a calendar, we will introduce those in the calendar, and also the budget you would require for your activities, because we need to make the budget for this financial year also. Congregations who had commitments towards the souvenir may kindly do the needful, as the souvenir has already been released, so the commitments which are left, kindly do the needful. Those of you who have not collected their copy of souvenir and were part of the souvenir contribution may kindly do so and collect your copy from Jacob. Every Wednesday we have the congregational intercessory prayer time, 7 to 8 p.m. online. The congregation is encouraged to join in this prayer time. The Sunday service is in the sanctuary, but you can also attend on the YouTube. You can make your commitments, thanksgivings, pledges through electronic mode, NEFT, and also through checks. Kindly contact Jacob in this regard. Thank you.
Thank you, Elvis. We shall spend for a moment of silence as we disperse and prepare ourselves for the time of fellowship with each other.